मॉर्निंग चिल्ड्रेन, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू बिगिन विद अ न्यू लेसन इन केमिस्ट्री, द नेचर ऑफ मैटर, दैट इज क्लासिफिकेशन ऑफ मैटर. नाउ इफ यू रिमेम्बर इन द प्रीवियस क्लासेस आई हैव ऑलरेडी गिवन यू सम नोटबुक वर्क टू राइट द डेफिनेशंस ऑफ दिस चैप्टर इन द नोटबुक. नाउ वी आर गोइंग टू सी द एक्सप्लेनेशन पार्ट ऑफ इट. राइट, इन द प्रीवियस चैप्टर वी हैड ऑलरेडी लर्न चिल्ड्रेन दैट मैटर एग्जिस्ट इन थ्री डिफरेंट स्टेट्स. That is, it exists in the state of a solid, liquid, and gas. Okay? And the difference in the state is due to the difference in the physical state and the molecular arrangements. Now, physical state, you know, if we take an example of water, suppose, the physical state of water in solid, liquid, and gas is very different from each other. The solid state of water is ice, which looks exactly different and very different from the liquid state of water that you drink. And that liquid state of water looks very different from the water vapor, that is the gaseous state of water. So the physical state differs of each state of matter. And why it differs? Because of the molecular arrangement. That means the way the molecules are arranged in it, because of that it differs. Coming further, and we see how the matter is classified into the various categories. Now, first it is classified into two pure categories, children. The first category is pure substances and mixtures. Now, what are pure substances? Pure substances have constant composition and are always homogeneous. That means if you will look at it, a pure substance, children, you will not be able to see any difference throughout the mixture. Homogeneous means it is same throughout. There is no difference. Suppose if you take a glass of water, you will not see any difference in any part of the glass of water. It looks homogeneously the same. That means it is same throughout, right? It has a constant composition. Composition means how it is made up of what things it is made up of. So pure water, if you take a glass of pure water, you will see it is uniform. The whole liquid looks the same. So that is known as a pure substance and that is homogeneous. Now, I'll tell you one more example of heterogeneous also, children. Suppose you take a glass of water and you put some sand into it and then you stir it. You will see the sand particles floating and moving separately in the glass of water. That happens because that is a heterogeneous mixture. But in a glass of water, we will not see anything because it is a homogeneous mixture. The next is a mixture. Now, what is a mixture, children? Mixtures have variable composition and may be homogeneous as well as heterogeneous. Like right, I told you that mixtures, a glass of water, if you put sand into it, that is known as a mixture. If we take a glass of water and put milk into it, that is known as a homogeneous mixture. So mixtures are of two kinds, homogeneous or heterogeneous. And all the pure substances and mixtures together are the various parts of matter. Right? So this is the first broad classification, and the same classification you have seen onto the this diagram also that you have seen on page number 40. Okay. Now we see the classification of pure substances further. Pure substances are further divided into elements. Now what are elements, children? A pure substance which cannot be broken into two or more pure substances by any chemical means is called an element. Now for understanding this better, children, you can understand with any word. Suppose I have a word book. I can break the word book into B, O, O and K. But can you further break B into anything simpler or O into anything simpler or K into anything simpler? No, it is not possible. So that B, O, O and K are known as the alphabets of the word book. In the same way, children, in chemistry, we have the smallest thing that cannot be broken into anything simpler, and that smallest pure substance is known as element. Like we have gold, we have silver, we have iron, we have oxygen, hydrogen. So these are all elements which cannot be broken into anything further. In all, there are about 118 different elements which have been identified till today. Some of these elements have been made by scientists, while most of them are occurring naturally. That means some of these elements have been made by scientists also, and many of them are naturally occurring. Underline, children, those elements which will occur naturally are known as natural elements. If these elements are found in a nature, then these elements are known as natural elements. Like we have oxygen, we have nitrogen, we have carbon, we have gold, we have silver. These are all naturally occurring elements. Some of these elements can also emit harmful radiations. Underline, children. Some of these elements can also emit harmful radiations. And if they emit harmful radiations, they are known as radioactive elements. Now, radioactive elements are such elements, children, that keep on giving out radiations every time, which can be very harmful. Right? Now, further, these elements are divided into four categories, children. Metals, non-metals, metalloids, and inert gases. Right? So, these are the four categories into which all elements are divided. Metals, non-metals, metalloids, and inert gases. Now, metal. Metals are electropositive element. Now, what does the word electropositive mean, children? In detail, this word will be explained to you in the higher classes. But for now, you can understand, children, because metals donate the electrons that are said to be electropositive. They are usually found in the combined state in the earth crust. Metals usually combine with the other elements and then they are taken out from the surface of the earth. Metals have a shiny surface. Now, when we say metals, children, you can take an example of gold, silver. These are all metals. They shine. Even mercury, you can take an example, children. You have seen it in the thermometer. It's a metal that also shines. Another property of metals is they produce a sound when they are being bitten. Now, you take a piece of iron, any iron object, and you strike it with some stick or some other metal piece, you will see a peculiar sound is heard. So, metals are sonorous. That means they produce a sound. Symbols of the metals. Now, because the spellings of metals writing every time when the reactions and all were being written or anything, discoveries of the metals were being done, it was seen that writing the spellings of metals was taking a lot of time. So, what these people did was, these alchemists and all and the scientists, they discovered a short form of the metal spelling to be written, and that short form of the metal spelling is known as a symbol. Now, every time I want to write potassium, I don't need to write the full spelling, I can just write the symbol, that is K, a capital K. If I want to write hydrogen, I will write a capital H. If I want to write oxygen, I will write it as capital O. So why this only H or O or K? Those short forms are known as symbols. So this is the definition of symbol, children. Now, this I had given you in the last class to be done. This is C. This is the name of the element, that is a metal. This is the symbol. Okay. Now, one thing to be kept in mind, children, you have to learn how to write these symbols, and the way it is written, children, you have to write it in the same way. That means if magnesium is asked, the symbol is a capital M with a small g, and without joining them in the joining handwriting. Now, many a time children learn the symbol Mg and they write it in exams as Mg. They combine it and join it together. That will become wrong. See, it's a capital M separated by a small g. Aluminium, a capital A with a small L. Now, L is not written in this way. L is not written in this way. See how it is written. So these things have to be kept in mind and you have to learn them exactly they are written. Okay. On the other side, see, children, there was one more table that you have written. Now see this, what is the importance of the Latin name? Usually each element is denoted by the first letter of the symbol. That means to make it easy, they use the first letter of the spelling, carbon. So they took the first letter of the spelling, capital C. Now many elements had the same first letter, so over there the confusion started. So what these people discovered was they started taking the first two letters. See, calcium, the first two were taken. Why? Because carbon is also with C, calcium is also with C. Then again the confusion started. So what they did was some of the elements are taken from their Latin name, right? Their Latin name, right? So, lead has the Latin name as plumbum. Now, lead has a symbol PB. Now, PB is nowhere in the spelling of lead. Why? Because lead, the symbol is taken from its Latin spelling, that is plumbum. Now, this is telling you their Latin names. Sodium, the Latin name is natrium. That is why Na. Potassium is kalium, K. iron, ferrum, Fe, copper, cuprum, Cu, silver, argentum, gold, aurum, lead, plumbum, mercury, hydrargyrum, tin, stannum, and tungsten, wolfram. You will have to learn these, and you have to learn these also. Okay, coming to the next, non-metals. Just the opposite of the metals are non-metals, children. Non-metals underline are electronegative, because non-metals always accept the electrons. They are known as electronegative. Details in the higher classes. Non-metals do not possess luster. That means they will not shine. And even they are not sonorous. That means when you beat them with some metal, they will not produce any kind of a sound. See the non-metals. Generally, the non-metals are gases. So they will not produce any sound. You know that. Like hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen. Symbols H, N, O. And these are all capital letters. So you also have to write the capitals only, children. Okay? See the other symbols. Okay? Coming to metalloids. Now, metalloids is the third group of elements that shares the property of metals and non-metals. Metalloids are the elements whose properties are intermediate. That means some properties it shows of metals and some properties it shows of non-metals. On the next page, see, these are the names of the non-metals. At least two or three of them you should learn, and the symbols of all of them. Coming to the last group, that is noble gases, children. Now, noble gases are also known as rare gases because these are all gases only. And they are found in our earth crust, in our atmosphere. These gases are stable. That means they will not react with any other gas. They don't show any reaction. And that is why they are termed to be inert gases.